Look a couple up. And then look at Paul. Paul began his lengthy career in comic books in 1947. He left Aberdeen and he went to Sydney. Now what had happened is he'd seen a newspaper strip. Silver Star in the Flamework, Stanley Pitt. He went to some newspaper and walked in and asked, could he speak to Stanley Pitt? And Stanley Pitt came out and Paul said, I want to do what you do. I want to work with you, I want to work for you. At the age of 17, Paul was put to work by Stanley Pitt. By the age of 18, he had entered 20 issues of Second Life of Yarmak. He also inked Captain Power for Stanley Pitt's newspaper strip at the time. Paul was inking Stanley Pitt at the age of 17. Now, I shouldn't have to tell anyone here who Stanley Pitt was or what Stanley Pitt could do. And if you look at Stanley Pitt's work, and you think that this young man at the age of 17 had the sheer tenacity and guts to walk in and say, I want a job. And not only do I want your job, I want to work with you. I want to work for you, to be able to walk in and do that. And do it in such a way that Stan Pitt then took him under his wing and showed him how to create, how to make a character, how to write, how to draw, what he needed to do. Not just draw in your head, how to draw things. That is one of the ballsiest things you'll ever find in any Australian comic book creator. That is courage. That's a young man taking on the master. Paul kept doing work for Stanley Pitt until Captain Power stopped going. So Paul had to go back to Aberdeen and picked up work as a jack-hammer operator. Either way, he was working on the highways. He'd given up his dream. Then he was given an opportunity. H. John Edwards is a publisher. Well, was a publisher. He's long dead now. H. John Edwards was a publisher who published, let's say, short. He picked up the dregs of the American things. Lucky Duck. Things like that. Things that nobody ever heard of. But H. John Edwards was a very rich man because he also picked up one person and one creation that traded a lot of money. And that was Len Lawson and the Lone Avenger. So H. John Edwards was very rich. And he'd seen Paul's work and talked to Stan. And said, who did this? It's Paul Behill. So he hired Paul Behill. So Paul quickly ran back from Aberdeen back to Sydney and took up residence and started drawing and writing. And was published the back of the Lone Avenger, the Hood Ranger, all these other little comic books. It wasn't enough. He was then hired by Charles Young. He went to Charles Young. He'd seen in Life magazine an article about David Drummond. He went to Charles Young, that Young's merchandise, and went, you should do a comic book called David Trotter. It'll sell heaps. So Young's went, what the hell, why not? So they did. And then, of course, what happened? Walt Disney imported into Australia the David Trotter TV series. Put it loose. Money in the bank. So from there, the world was his oyster. He created a character which nobody can forget if they've ever read the Panther. Now the Panther is one of Australia's longest running creator-owned, what should we call it? Let's just call it a comic book. He did it for 73 issues. He started in 1953 and finished in 1967. He only finished because Charles Young died and the company went under. And as we know, in the early 1960s, the Australian comic book industry, it imploded. Everyone was put out of work. You had people like Maurice Brownlee, you had Stanley Pitt himself, you had Bill Belton, you had all these people that were just unemployed. They had nothing. Some of them kept going doing covers, like Hugh Chatto and Brownlee, and some of them just went into newspaper strips and into advertising, and they worked there and made careers. Some of them just left the comic book industry altogether. They vanished. Not Paul. After he created the Phantom, he created the Raven. The Raven only went for a few issues because Paul wasn't interested. and Young's went under, so he gave up. So he was faced at the age, he was probably in his mid-30s, what am I going to do now? Oh, in my mid-30s, I've had 6 months experience as a jackhammer operator and I was trained as a meat worker. And I've not done any of that work since I was 17. I'm screwed. Enter Stampede. Stampede came to Paul and said, I've got a job. I've got something for you. Stampede had been working for Cleveland Publishers, another publisher. And he'd been doing these beautiful, beautiful cover art paintings for Western pulp magazines and science fiction. Romance, you name it. Stan drew it, you could care less, you made money, you could draw it. Cleveland were looking for someone to write. So, Paul went in and he's like, all right, can you write westerns? I grew up in the bush. I lived it. I can write it. He wrote 800 novels from 1965 through to 1996. He used about 12 pen names. And a lot of those novels had cover art paintings by Stan, his mentor, his best friend. They looked out for each other. And he just kept humping these things. He would pump out 3 novels a week. 250 pages per book. Now, how many of you write? How many of you here actually write? I write. I can't. If you push me and held a gun to my head and a knife to my throat and told me you're going to string my cat up outside, I can knock out 10,000 words in a day. I would crap, but I'll be there. Paul would knock that out in an hour. He would knock out these books. And he would pump them out and he made money. He was popular. Americans loved Paul B. Wheelahan's books. None of them had his name on their own. Not one. Try to find a Western from Cleveland in a Stampede cover written by Paul B. Wheelahan. Doesn't exist. Look under his many pen names. Many of them. Hundreds of them. In fact, Paul estimated 100. I'm tempted to think that there were probably a lot more that he just forgot about. Because after a while, he just comes about. He wrote them about his experiences. He wrote them about when he was growing up as a kid. The things he saw, the things he heard, the things he'd done. That was Paul. In the middle of writing these 800 novels, as if there wasn't enough, he got bored. As he did. So what did he do? He pitched an idea for a television series, which only went for a couple. Rescue Island. I never saw it. I didn't know it. I never saw it. But he pitched it. They got picked up. It ran. With his foot in the door, writing scripts, he wrote a country practice. Wrote several episodes of it. So he's writing. This is a comic book artist. Writing pop western novels in a country practice and making money doing it and being successful at it. He got bored of that too, so he said, no, no. Care less. Kevin Patrick put him back in the comic books, believe it or not. Because Kevin tracked him down and said, why don't you do some more Panther comics? And Paul went, oh, don't bother. Okay, fine. So he did another 4 or 5. Made no money whatsoever. Kevin was very happy. I would have put money on it. I could care less about that money than that. He was back in the game. And I'll tell you what, his Panther comics that he produced for Kevin in the early 2000s were just as good, if not better, than the ones he did back in the 50s and 60s. He lost none of his skills. He hadn't picked up a pen to draw since he gave up in 1965. But he kept going with it. And it was always there. Now, you'll learn a lot more about Paul when you pick up the journal and you read what Kevin's written. What I want to leave you with is Paul's own words. Now, Paul can't be his wife. Understandable. The man was born in 1930. I think he's going to drag himself up the stairs, unfortunately. And I don't blame him. I'm going to be 50. I don't want to drag myself up the stairs. All right. But Paul, back in 1965, wrote to another person that a lot of you people here should know. And probably do know. John Ryan. John Ryan was one of the first comic book historians of Australian origins. He wrote panel by panel back in the late 1970s. And 1960s, started contacting all of these people that he'd grown up reading. And he started by going through the white pages and pulling out names and just writing to them. Are you the footballer that drew this comic book for K.G. Murray back in 1942? No. Okay. Are you the... Yes. Great. Phil, love you. Are you the John Dixon? Yes. Oh, by the way, John, can you tell me how to get in touch with Stan Kent? Yes. And along the way, he got in touch with Bobby Hitler. He got in touch with him 2 years after he'd stopped drawing books. And he asked him some questions. And he sent him a couple of copies of his newsletter that he was doing at the time. Now, in the newsletter, people would, as they do now, they critiqued. Jeez, Paul Verhoeven, that looks like shit. That looks like Steve Ditko. I bet he ripped off Steve Ditko. That's what people were saying. The Raven was good, the Panther was crap. And that's what they were saying. So he said this to Paul. Now Paul, at that point, he heard every criticism of this. What if it does matter? Who cares? You either bought it, you read it, you did it, didn't matter. But he wanted to address some of these criticisms. And one of the criticisms he wanted to address was that someone had written, and John had printed, that the Panther was a ripoff of the Phantom. Heresy. This is what Paul had to say. Can you find the right thing? The Panther, despite rumors to the contrary, was not lifted from the Phantom, although I'll be the first to admit similarity. The name was conceived first. And tell me if any of this sounds very familiar. It sounded very much when I was looking at this to a very famous character that's going to be mentioned very shortly. Then I said about constructing a character to fit it. One doesn't have a bloke in a tux and a cup and called the Panther. So what about costume? Naturally, that costume would be black. And the general design, as favored by the band, Superman, Batman, etc. His origin was a Tarzan type in the African jungle. He was reared initially by panthers, captured at their 10 years of age by natives. He began to guard himself in panther skins in an attempt to look black like his new people. Hence the logic, as far as it could be expected, in his costume. I was after an effect which you can see on the cover of the first issue. However, as Panther progressed, he became more muscular, he became bigger, and he looked like the after and before and after and after. I trimmed him, but he never did return to the likeness of the early drawings. As for the Raven, I agree that the Raven was a better original theme than the Panther. This is Paul's words, not mine, I don't believe, but here we go. I felt the character could have expanded into something very good if I hadn't run out of interest and switched to writing. When it came to artists, Paul didn't hold back. He wasn't influenced by many people. And John asked him, who are your artistic influences? Who did you grow up looking like? And what about this thing that your artwork looks very suspiciously like Steve Ditko? How does this happen? The first day I became interested in comics and artwork, this is what Paul told John and I. 20 years ago, when I was 14, I regarded the work of Stanley Pitt as the finest, not only in Australia, but in the world. I have seen nothing in the intervening years to change that opinion, either locally, produced or imported. When he was pressed, and John kept pressing, there must be someone else but Stanley Pitt, sure. He started to name them. Sid Nichols. He said, I loved him. I loved Minute Alone. Could care less of anything, hated it. Minute Alone, those pirate stories. Poof, loved them. And then, John, what about the Americans? Surely the Americans. No, Milton Caniff, he said, I like him. Hal Foster, yeah, got him on the Tarzan stuff. Alex Raymond, Speed Gordon, he was reading it when it was called Speed Gordon. It wasn't called Flash Gordon. Called Speed Gordon, because back in the day, Flash meant that you were a bit of a mug there. So they didn't say Flash Gordon, they called him Speed. Even the movie series were called Speed Gordon. So you liked him. That was it. Three people. Then, he asked John, send him some Steve Ditko, because I couldn't hear about this guy. Ditko. I've never seen him. So come here. Seen the whole bunch of time here. Hey, look at this. What do you think? Better leave him either. Tom Gavinetta. I could see my work in Spider-Man right off, and I couldn't get over the similarity in style. I feel that Ditko handles anatomy and action in a very similar manner, rapidly in some aspects, and smoothly in others. So, very interesting, I believe, to take some of the Panther to see Ditko and say, Steve, have a look at this. Does that remind you of something? Considering that when Paul was joining the Panther, he'd never even heard of this man, let alone seen him. And when Ditko was joining Spider-Man, I guarantee you he would never have heard of Paul Verhoeven, let alone seen him, yet they had the same artistic style. That is remarkable when you think about it. One in America, one here in Sydney, drawing exactly the same. That is the mark of a small world, and that is the mark of all those influences coming in into the one person. It's unfortunate that Paul can't be here tonight to receive his award, which he's richly deserves, and he really does need it. What I would like for everyone here now is to please be upstanding and applaud Paul Verhoeven as we award him in absentia with his Ledger of Honour for 2017.
It will look good in your mouthpiece. There we go.